the party and make it to where your audio can be heard. Xbox, unsnap. Make it a good one.
Penis burger.
There it is.
All right.
In one word, that's my review of The Division. Penis burger. If you didn't look twice, you'd think it was all right, but then you realize you've seen the big pile of
them. The Division spent hours and hours collecting clothes only a middle-aged white guy who hikes wears.
And you know what?
The only thing I'm missing is hiking, and I wouldn't even wear them.
Oh my god, is that an olive scarf? Fantastic. That'll go great with my L.L. Bean jacket I'm wearing. Carries my fucking ammo.
The stupidest part about the whole fucking thing is that Dave got that purple jacket, and I'm like, Dave, you need to get a purple hat and purple boots, and he did, and I started calling him Purple Dave, and two fucking days later, Prince died. So
that's your fault, so you killed Prince.
Yeah, good job.
Yeah, I killed Prince. Yeah, that was a pretty big bummer. So.
It's been a shitty year. Prince died, Muhammad Ali died, Kimbo Slice died.
I don't give a fuck about... I give more of a shit about Kimbo Slice dying than I do Muhammad Ali dying.
What?
Muhammad Ali was a draft-dodging racist. And he fucking decided that, you know, I'm going to get Alzheimer's or whatever. He had Parkinson's disease. And I'm just going to fucking... I'm going to keep fighting at 40 years old and losing to no-name punks when I clearly have early-onset Parkinson's disease. And he just fucking... He fucked himself on that. He should have just gone to Vietnam with the rest of the men and gotten killed there. At least people would remember him favorably, as opposed to shaking his fucking fists around.
I think you're literally the only person on the planet I've ever heard say a negative thing about. So I'm pretty sure everybody remembers him favorably, except for you.
He was a shit-talking motherfucker. He was. Go back and look at some fucking film of that.
I have. I've watched
asshole.
Every single one of his fights. They're all amazing.
Yeah, and you know, and he just, I'm so much fucking better than all of you Uncle Toms
here's
out
something.
There. Yeah, he's calling
here's
people
something
Uncle Toms, but he couldn't
here's
go to
something.
Fucking
wait a minute,
Vietnam
wait a
with the rest
here's
of
here's something.
Men.
There is a video, right? Who the fuck did he, who is he fighting? What was the big name? Not Foreman.
Sonny Liston. He was
yeah,
the guy called
was
an Uncle Tom,
all right.
And he was Liston was the favorite in that fight. He was calling him an Uncle Tom the whole fucking time.
He went
and then
to
he
his,
knocked
he
him
went
down
to his,
and
you
stepped
remember,
up.
Hey, did you see he went to his house in his tour bus and was yelling outside his house like, you ain't nothing, you ain't this and that, blah, blah, blah. So he comes up to him. There's
he
footage of this. This is the most gangster shit I've ever seen in my life, right? He goes up to him. Sonny Liston's gambling. He's at a table, and Muhammad Ali comes up with this whole entourage, and talking shit, blah, blah, blah. Sonny Liston turns around, pulls a gun out, and fires the gun, right? So Muhammad Ali and his friends run out of there. And then all of a sudden, Sonny Liston, still calm as shit, opens up his jacket and fires the gun again, and it was a fake gun. He got a Hollywood gun, it was shooting blanks, and went back to gambling. And fucking didn't phase him. That was like, that was the most gangster thing I think I've ever seen. He just pulled a fucking gun out, fired it, and hear everybody go, ugh! And he looks at everybody and goes,
there you go.
Like, he makes
there
that
you
face
go.
Like,
case in
come
point.
On, it's
hey,
fake.
John, case in point right here, right now. The baddest man in the world was afraid of a goddamn cap gun. I mean, are you serious?
You're telling me that if you were talking shit to someone, they pull out a gun, you're not gonna run.
I would have shit myself.
Yeah, whatever.
I just thought that
Sonny
Liston had the balls to do that.
If you're sitting down, not paying attention, and I light a fucking firework off, you're gonna run. If you think a guy's got a gun and he's going to shoot you, you're not standing there to continue talking shit.
Hey, WWMD. What would Mike would have done? What would Mike Tyson have done? Mike Tyson would have punched that motherfucker right in the face because
Mike would have put him through the crap stable.
Absolutely, Mike Tyson would have stood up like a goddamn man.
I will
man.
Say this. Now Muhammad Ali, I feel
Will
the same
Smith
way.
Played,
right,
how
he,
bad
right,
could he
I'll
possibly
this,
been? Will Smith
this.
Be the
I'll
guy
say,
who's
I'll
gonna represent
this.
You on screen?
I'll tell you this. I look at Muhammad Ali to Mike Tyson how I look at Dr. J to Michael Jordan. Yeah, they're cool and everything, but I never got to see him in my lifetime, so I don't have that same connection as I do, like, Michael Jordan. Like, Dr. J is awesome. I wasn't around for it. I got to see the footage, and it was cool, and I totally respect him. You know, he's a fucking icon. But if you had to say who, like, would mean more, it's fucking... It's Michael Jordan, because I was there for it. And that's how I feel with, like, Muhammad Ali and Mike Tyson. You know what I mean? Like, I look at Mike Tyson more, because I'm like, yo, I remember his fight. I remember yeah. my mom, we went over to her mom's house, her friend's house, they watched the fight, and I remember I thought the guy died. I asked mom if the guy died, because yeah. everybody jumped out. It was, I forget who he knocked out, but the guy fell out of the ring. And I was like, did he die?
Like, well, you know what? And the thing was,
I remember that shit, you know what I mean? Like,
with Mike Tyson, that was always a reasonable question to ask, you know what I mean? Because he was an absolute monster. But let me tell you, the whole thing with Muhammad Ali, I don't disrespect him as a boxer. He was a hell of a boxer. I just think that over the years, people started to overstate his greatness because they were echoing the sentiment that he put out through his public relations for the last 40 years. And then he got Parkinson's disease, and who's going to talk shit about someone with Parkinson's disease? My grandmother had it and they killed him. My grandmother had it and they killed him. But the fact of the matter is that all he did for the last 30 years of his life was go to sporting events and throw those weak-ass air punches at cameras. Oh, yeah, remember, I used to box? Now he can't even throw down his own fucking underwear. You know what I mean? Like, that's... It's the truth. It's the fucking truth.
I'm pretty sure that we've all pretty much secured a spot in hell by now. But I'm pretty sure you just earned yourself a spot.
Oh yeah, I punched my ticket when I was like 9.
But no, think about it. Think about this though. Is that with all that, the last 30 years, John, you, me, Josh, all our collective. Memories of the living version of Muhammad Ali. All his accomplishments came before we were born. So all we've known is this vegetable for our whole lives.
That's what I'm saying. That's why I look at him the same way
right.
I do Dr. J.
But you gotta understand, too, that the stupid asshole didn't need to have that happen. He fucking kept putting himself... There's documentaries out there watching. They're fucking following him in his lead up to his last couple of fights or whatever. And everybody could see, this guy's got something wrong. He's gonna get his ass beat by a nobody. This is not good. And they let him do it. They let him get his ass beat some more. And I guarantee you that led to some
To play devil's advocate, I wouldn't necessarily say that's all him. For all we know, that could be, you know how crooked boxing is. That's promoters. Yeah. Of course they're gonna let him fight. That's gonna bring in that promotion company a fuck ton of money. Same thing with Mike Tyson on the way out. He's fighting all these bums, but who cared? It was Mike Tyson. I can make money off this. You know what I mean? So, yeah. I mean, look at the biggest disappointing fight in the history of boxing, I totally think, is the Pacquiao-Mayweather fight.
Yep.
The most overrated, overhyped boxing, you know, this match was supposed to happen. Like Final Fantasy. It was supposed to come out for 20 years. You know, we've been hearing about it, and then it finally comes out.
And that takes us to a really good point. Let's actually start talking about what we came here to talk about, instead of Muhammad Ali's fucking legacy. Because it's good that we got Jesse on a rant. It's just bad that it's a rant that it's not about anything video game related. Clear the
area, Cyrus.
Hey,
you know what?
All right, I'll say this.
I'll make it video game related. They never made a video game where Muhammad Ali was the final boss and you couldn't beat him. How does that sound? All you would have had to do is wait there. All you would have had to do is kick him and fucking push him down. He's not going to defend himself. He was incapable. It would have been the most boring video game of all time.
Okay, so we're going to do our review on The Division.
It's bad.
What made it bad?
All right, so
I would say... I would
Mom.
Say it's that classic
red
case
barrel.
Of it had a good idea and it was executed poorly. You know what I mean? Because as much as we're joking about it, I will admit this. When's the last time, Jesse, even though, yeah, the game got frustrating at points and that, but that's been the longest co-op game we've played. And, you know, collectively, getting Steve, Dave, everybody on it at the same time. For those first couple weeks having the game, It was a lot of fun. It really was. I was enjoying myself. It was cool that we could all go through the city together. You know what I mean? And
oh yeah, no, it's a great idea. It's like a it's like going over and doing that 500-mile pilgrimage they have over there in fucking Europe somewhere, where you go walking and seeing all these religious places and these amazing visuals and, you know, fucking mountain ranges and cultures. It sounds like a great idea. Until you've been walking for 250 fucking miles, everything starts to look green. You know, everything starts to just, all right, there's another tree. Okay, I get it. That's what the division was for me, is that basically, once you've been playing it for a week, we all saw everything that there was to see. And then the game wanted you to keep going. And the problem was is that once you got to the end of the road, you ended up with this fucking cavern of disparity between walking around the city, seeing a guy every 5 minutes who's a level 27 that takes 3 bullets to die, and then going into the dark zone, and you can't do shit about anyone or anything anywhere at any time. That was a huge problem. And the worst part of it, like what you said, John, is that it's not like we played this for 10 minutes and we're like, ah, this is no good. Everybody I know played this game for fucking like 50 hours, which is more than enough time to establish the fact that they just didn't do their job in keeping everything level and interesting for the long haul. They just didn't do it.
And you know what scares me about this game? Because Destiny, that was what felt, as far as me personally, that's what I think felt extra cool. Because Destiny, I didn't like, I understand the random loot drop, I get that idea, but it's like the same thing where you can set your fucking slot machine to hit less, hit the jackpot less, you know what I mean? So there's that sweet spot you want to hit to where, hey, keep me coming back, let me win enough to where I'll keep playing, you know what I mean?
And
let me
no
lose
excuses.
Enough to keep
they
trying.
Got no
and Destiny turned that shit all the way down to like a 1% chance, you know? That's what it felt like to me. Like the day I remember when I took Destiny back was the day I think I was doing a raid or a strike or something and was doing it all fucking day because this guy is apparently supposed to drop this shit. And then soon enough, it was either, it might have been multiplayer, I'm not sure, but somebody jumped in the party and in the last like half hour of it, we beat it. They got the fucking, the fucking awesome piece of art, the shit that I was looking for, and I didn't. I remember I just went, fuck this, I'm not playing this anymore. Like, like that pissed me off. And like with Josh, like Josh played the shit out of this game. Cyrus. And what sucks for me, and I think for him, is that he spent all this time, right, getting this armor. But some asshole can come in there at the last minute and by the stroke of fucking luck get the same thing that took him 10 hours for. And I look at that and go, see, that to me, that diminishes the point of that super cool fucking item. I want to see Josh running around and go, oh, fuck, he had to kill that boss in 30 seconds with his hand tied behind his back and a pistol that shot fucking, that was a squirt gun. You know what I mean? Like, that's like the most incredibly hard thing you can do. Then you go, oh, shit, you did that? Like, that's badass. Not like, hey, you happen to be at the right place and you got all seven. You know, and that's what turned me off from Destiny, and I think that like the Division is a little bit more forgiving. You're able to in the last couple patches find stuff more, but I think what worries me is about this trend with games it's that cell phone complex, that pay to play, that Clash of Clans shit. That's what scares me about games now. Is like, remember Clash of Clans? Fun as shit, right? For the first couple weeks, until it took a fucking week to build a fucking cannon or whatever, unless you want to pay for it. Pay for this to get it faster. And that's what I think with Destiny and Division is like, well, you can fucking spend all this time and maybe get it, or you can give, you know, give us some real money, you get these coins that can give you the, you know, and that
worries
me. But
you know what, John? In the Division, it's almost the opposite. It's because you went in here, and how many chunks of DLC did everybody get for free before the people who paid $40 for a season pass even caught a whiff of something that they were going to get that they paid for? So I think it's almost the opposite with Division. But going back to what you said about the loot drops and shit, the Division tried to overcompensate. They realized nobody was getting anything good. And then they just said, okay, well, everybody
can have
everything
good.
And that doesn't help either. And the worst part to me is that the Division and Destiny, I didn't have a lot of experience with Destiny, but I understand it's a similar loot system, everything.
Yeah, pretty much.
It's not like they were reinventing the wheel here. Borderlands did this successfully years ago. And that was Borderlands 2. Borderlands,
it was fucking, what was it? Diablo.
Diablo's been doing this for fucking 20 years. I mean, are you kidding me?
Yeah.
It's not like there wasn't a template for how to succeed. And they just sort of said, fuck it. It's New York. People will like it. You know what I mean? Come on.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's just, it's, I mean, it's tapping on something, but, like, I always feel like, with today's age, with the microtransaction, everything, I think it should be like this. If I was a game developer, my way would be, okay, look, you can, anything, like, first of all, any DLC, any, like, hey, pre-order this now or pay $1.99, you'll get this. I think any paid DLC that I would drop, I would make it attainable in the game. I hate that those days are over. I hate that, yeah, if you beat this mission in under a minute, you can get that gun. Like, fine, look, if you want to pay for it, I think you should get that gun. And I always thought, like, if you pay for something, like, for a competitive multiplayer game, like, if I made a competitive shooter, and it's like, all right, look, if you get 100 headshots with a pistol, you'll unlock the Desert Eagle, the gold version, right? Or you can go to our store for $4.99 and buy it. Yeah. And then my whole thing would be like, here's the caveat. The one you buy, it has a pink fucking smiley face on it, so everyone knows you bought it and didn't earn it.
Nice.
See, that would be my give and take. Huh?
I said nice vocab word. Caveat, well done.
Oh, yeah. How many days do you spend with Mr. Donovan after school? So
I just feel like if people are going to hear this, they got to know that, you know, hey, vocab matters, you know?
Oh, yeah, it does, baby.
John just earned some amazing DLC with that word.
He did. It's something that needs to be taken note of.
I want to provide a lot of content to give you
the best
experience.
This is for the parents out there. Just know this isn't just like a bad program for your kids to be watching. They can learn something.
Yep, for every 10 bucks, you get a caveat.
That's all right. I like it. We need a caveat counter. And a fuck counter.
I agree with you. I think that, yeah, if you're going to go ahead and let somebody fucking buy what should be earned, then you should let everybody else that earned it know that there is still a difference between you and the people who are just going to shortcut every chance they get.
Yeah.
And see, I'm playing right now. I
think it sets
right
a
now.
Bad
Here's
precedent for life. Like, yeah, buy your way to the top.
Yeah. Well, you know what? It's
almost pay to win. That whole pay to win thing, that drives me crazy because I feel like, first of all, I think anything you pay for, it should only be cosmetic. It shouldn't affect the gameplay. It shouldn't, because that's just, it's cheap. You know what I mean? Don't shoehorn me into fucking buying something. Like, that's what I was saying. Like, the whole Mortal Kombat thing with the DLC that me and you were talking about earlier. I felt like they were treating me dumb. You know what I mean? Like, I don't like that they don't, I got your $60, you dumbass. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
We made all the DLC already, and it's on the disc, but you got to, you got the one pack, but you didn't get the double pack. That's part of this thing. That's, you know, because it's getting so, like, I don't, like I said, I don't believe it.
Street Fighter V did something even stupider. And what's worse is that they want to be padded on the fucking back for it. They just now released a story mode. Like,
yeah, because people were pissed.
They're like, here's a free story mode. Of course it's free, you fucking retard. It should have been included with the game. Like, I get it. It's a fighting game. They don't have the best stories, but I still want it. Like, don't just cut it out.
Here's the thing. You know what it is now, they can't admit. None of the companies or publishers can admit. Let's be honest. These AAA games cost hundreds of millions of dollars to make, or tens of millions of dollars to make. They can't admit. Let's just be real. Every game we bought that's a big name game, it's $100. Yeah. Games are really $100. They fucking are. They're $100. And that's the profit, like, that's where they need to be sold for these developers to make a profit. And what I mean by that is like, I think this is why we feel, at least I feel, that when I buy a game, I feel like when I look at what they offer for the season pass and DLC, I go, oh, okay. So really, you're just only giving me 70% of this game, and I have to buy this the rest of the game so you guys break, you know, make your profit margin, because really, this game should be $100.
But that's not necessarily true. Like, look at The Witcher. Fucking, that, it's not true. The Witcher is a AAA game made for next to nothing. They gave out so much DLC, and the DLCs that you did pay for are the size of other fucking games.
Yeah, so it's not mutually exclusive. It's not like you can just do, no, this is the way that you do it, and everyone does it that way. There are people and companies and developers that do it that way, but it doesn't mean that it has to be done.
And more importantly,
like, I just feel like, I think
The Witcher, who did The Witcher again? It was like Red.
CD Projekt Red.
CD Projekt Red. CD Projekt Red was the kind of group that said, okay, we want to make a fucking great game. We want you to be happy with our game. And if you want more and you want to pay for it, okay, we'll accommodate that. But we're not going to strand you out on an island just because. Witcher 3 was the first game that I bought in fucking ages where I opened up the pack.
And you felt like you got your fucking money's worth for it.
Well, I opened up
the fucking
case.
And they gave you a thank you letter.
They gave you a thank you letter, but not even that. They gave you a they gave you the disc, they gave you stickers, they gave you this, they gave you that. I didn't get a special edition. I got whatever it was, and I opened it up, and it had all that in there, and they did. They took the time, and it's not a lot of time, mind you, but they took the time to write a paragraph thanking me for buying their game, appreciating me as a customer. And that's not something that's just disappeared, okay? I appreciate that. That's something that should still exist.
Exactly,
you know,
and that's why, and that's the point I'm trying to make is, like, see, that game, I felt like I got my money's worth. I got it. The DLC that they put in, which I've heard great things about it, was extra. But the standalone game by itself was like, damn, this is a fucking... This is the full, I got my money's worth. But when you play something like the Division or a Capcom game, I feel like I gave you $60. You didn't give me $60 worth of game. That's how I feel.
Like that's the other point I was trying to make. Like a game like The Witcher, where it's so much detail and so much story and voice acting, this, that, whatever. Like you can see the production value in it. I'm sorry, I know the games can't be easy to make, but Street Fighter V does not look like it should have taken Capcom millions and millions and millions
exactly. of dollars. Exactly, that's what I'm saying. Yeah, Street Fighter V doesn't have to be an
especially
open world
fucking RPG
game. Especially
when you initially didn't even put in
the
fucking story.
But you should be able to make
mode.
It look...
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
No,
exactly.
I played through Vega's little story thing, and it seriously took me, I think it was 3 fights, 10 minutes, and then they gave me 3 still screens of, like, what I considered to be conception
art. Which is insulting.
You know what I mean? Yeah, it was like, you know, conceptual artwork. That was, it said, you know, like, all right, let's go get a fucking hamburger. Like, that's really, like, all I got. I don't remember it at all, you know? And I like Vega. I like Ryu. I like characters in that game. I like characters that they didn't include for some reason. You know what I mean? I get that you want to add, you know, new shit all the time. But the fact is that some shit just belongs there. Like, Blanka belongs in fucking Street Fighter. I'm sorry. You know, maybe that's because I was fucking 15 back in the early 90s or, you know, or the late 90s or something like that. But he just feels like he belongs there.
Yeah.
So when you're not giving me shit like that, that should be a staple. That's kind of like going to a basketball game and they just, no one brought a basketball. Like, you know what I mean? Like, all right, well, what are we going to do now? You know? You're missing key components to what identifies you as a city.
It's what is, what I guess the question is what is $60 worth in as far as video games? You know what I mean? And that's why I look at one end of it. Like you said, $60 is The Witcher. Man, that's the fucking game I got. The other end of the spectrum is Capcom Street Fighter V or whatever. I mean, you go, this should have been $20. You know what I mean? Like, this should have been $30. Like, it shouldn't have been $60.
What was the game where they had DLC on the disc that you had to pay to unlock? Like
Marvel vs. Capcom 3. Marvel vs. Capcom. Pretty much every Capcom game ever.
Yeah,
ever
so
since they
make
doing
all
DLC,
this content.
They do that. Like, say, yeah, hey, here's, you gotta pay for this, but it's on the disc.
Yeah.
Exactly. So that's why I'm saying is they do that because it cost $100 to make that game. You know what I mean? Like, it cost them 80. The what they're selling it for at 60, they're not gonna make a profit. So what they do is they take what's already on that disc, what they already made, and lock it away, and go, okay, look at $60. We spent all our money on, let's say, advertising, budgeting, whatever we made. The Street Fighter commercial with fucking whoever, Tony Jaa in it, and now we're over budget. Like, we gotta take back the three characters and make them pay for it.
But what they have to understand is game developers.
I think the biggest example of, like, a game being made and then being cut into a billion pieces by the makers is Destiny. I feel like Destiny was on a completely different track when they first came up with it, and it was literally going to be probably one of the best games ever, and then they just said, you know what, we can cut this into 50 different pieces, and that's what they did.
Sell it and make more,
And they gave us, at the beginning, it was still a good game, it was fun, I enjoyed the shit out of it, but the longer I played it, the more DLC came out, and the more I realized that every bit of progress I made, all that hard work I put in, getting the armor or weapons and this and that, and going through the raids 1,000 times, like, it didn't matter. None of it mattered, because the second the new DLC dropped, somebody could pick up the game for the first fucking time, do a couple of missions, buy the armor that was there at the Citadel, and they're caught up with me. Like, they're there. Yeah. And I hate that. Like, give me... And, they, you know, later on, they made it to where you could upgrade your weapons and shit like that, and kind of make them relevant. But then they'd still... You still don't... It's still bullshit. Like, it's just
The digital equivalent of a participation trophy, the way that I see it. Is that, you know what I mean? You're just going to let everybody be number one all the time, and that's not how number one works.
Like, I get you got to find something in the middle of, like, okay, now the game is too daunting for anybody new to ever want to play it. But you can't just have everybody who's been here since day one just be completely shat on every fucking time. And that's what it was coming down to.
Well, because especially when you're making a new IP, because that's your core demographic. Those are the people that are going to go buy your expansion packs, are going to go buy Destiny 2, is those first people who were there day one, tried it, liked it. You know what I mean? The fucking, you know, that's your core set. So when you go, hey, fuck that, we can do this, where, you know, you new guys coming in here, yeah, we'll give you everything. You can start off at level 30. Just, you know, buy the game. It's like, yeah, it's a total slap in the face.
I know that Destiny has fixed a lot of that shit.
It's like buying a cheeseburger at McDonald's, and then like an hour later they go, it's free cheeseburgers for everybody.
I know that Destiny has fixed a lot of its problems, and like I have this friend that, like, literally that's all he plays, but he treats it like a fucking job. Like, okay, I gotta get up early so I can run the daily and the weekly, and I gotta do this. Like, he took
that's what I've been doing with the Division,
he took the fun out of the game. Like, that he's half the reason we all stopped, because he made us realize how fucking horrible it is. But like, it's bad. Like, it's bad when you have to be fixing a game as people are playing it and everything like that. Like, I'd rather you not release it at the time when you did, then give me an incomplete game where by the time I'm exhausted with it, then you start fixing all the problems.
You know, that's great you mentioned that, because that totally, I'd have to say in the last 5 years, maybe longer than that, I think the one thing I hate about gaming now the most is fucking release dates or releasing games that are not
letting
done.
Us know that they're coming down the pipe.
Sick of it. Know who everyone needs to take a page out of their book is Rockstar. Grand Theft Auto has never released a fucking date when they're like, hey, when's the next Grand Theft Auto come out? When we're done with it. that's all they say. And then when they finally do release it, the game's already been printed, shipped, ready to go. You know what I mean? When I got Grand Theft Auto 5, there was no day one patch for 7 gigs or something to fix something. It ran great. It worked. You know what I mean?
And like, the multiplayer didn't work.
I'm so sick. Oh, yeah, it did. Yeah, I didn't. Yeah, you're right about that. Yeah, the multiplayer didn't work at all. But for the most part, I mean, the core game, you know, GTA, it worked, you know? But, I'm just so sick of just hearing about a game. Hey, you know, this game's coming out, blah, 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 in 6 months, and then it comes around. We're gonna have to push it back till 2017, and it's like, well, then why did you fucking say? Well, don't say anything.
Certain games too, like fucking Batman Arkham Knight, they recalled it from PC. Like they just okay, it doesn't exist
anymore.
Work. Like we will give you back your money.
Yeah,
right
it
now.
Just.
If you have this game, we apologize. Here's your money.
And I totally understand. Like I'm okay with it if you're going, hey. We're gonna hold on to this game to make it better. We found out this fucking glitch. Like Division, that's what should have happened with the Division. Is they should have held on and go, hey, some guy found out that he can run through the wall and kill this boss and do it over and over and over again and become super overpowered and kill everybody and break the game. You know what I mean? We're gonna hold on to it.
They should have found out that you can do everything there is to do in a week.
Yeah.
That's what they should have done.
Like,
The thing
weird,
that drives
you know,
me crazy about the Division is that they fucking got me. Like, I played the beta, I was so excited, I got my friends so excited, and then a week into, like, not like a moment of having it in my hand, I just was able to look down and say, oh, I bought Destiny again. Like, I was mad. And then my whole experience got ruined because my friends got the actual game before I did. I didn't get a chance to jump in with them right away. So then by the time I'm playing with them, they're level 30s, they're already in the Dark Zone, and they're having to, like, catch me up. And it's literally me running behind them, watching them kill everything,
yeah.
Me dying every 3 fucking seconds, just hoping to get up to their level soon enough. I'm still not up to their level because I was literally falling asleep playing the game because it was just the worst experience ever. Like, I'm really disappointed with this.
And I get it. I get that, you know, games cost lots of money and this and that, and then they're going to dump money into the DLC and they want everybody to buy it and all this stuff. But the thing that they got to remember too is that your core demographic, like John was saying, it's not people that can just shit out $60 whenever a new game comes out. The federal minimum wage, I don't even think is $10 yet, or it might be $10.
Not here. It's
somebody
not.
Has to work.
No, not here. It's still $8.16 or $8.20 or something.
So
like that
means somebody has to work an entire business day, a full 8-hour day, to pay for your game, probably minus tax. That's not your DLC. That's not anything else on top of that. That's not the T-shirt or the keychain or the fucking statue edition that costs $250 or anything
that
like
I want.
That. You know what I mean? Yeah.
That I want.
So,
I want that.
Yeah, and the Division one, I mean, they gave you a fucking watch at least. I couldn't imagine getting a guy wearing, you know, khaki chino jeans or.
You would have got an L.L. Bean book bag. You would have got a
L.L. Bean book bag. And yeah. Hey, check out my dude. He's so hardcore in his chinos and Doc Martens, you know? Like,
yeah,
that's
I got
that's
brown and I have light brown.
That's not a collector's edition I would have wanted. Yeah, the brown edition.
Yeah,
I mean,
you know what? Like, it wasn't.
But yeah,
I
get it though. I get it. People, you know, they need to make their money back. It's big business. I get it. But you got to understand that most people can't just throw money down like that all the time. And that when people do, if you're not prepared for them to do that, you're really screwing over yourself in the future because the next time when the Division 2 comes out, how many of us do you think are going to fall for it? I mean, it's going to be a Redbox, and Redbox gets some of that money too, so they're going to be maybe get a dollar or two out of me. They're not going to get $60 all over again, you know what I mean? So
yeah,
I can wear
absolutely.
A Indigo jacket or a fucking, you know what
I think
mean?
I've
some
learned
sort of
now. I've totally learned. I've finally made the choice that I'm not buying season passes anymore.
Yeah.
I think they're crooked. I think it's a gamble because remember Arkham Knight also got flagged for when they said about the whole DLC coming out and everyone's like, okay, what's in it? And they're like, well, we can't tell you that. But pre-order it, we will take you to your DLC pre-order now, but we're not going to tell you what you're getting.
And
it's like,
and we'll give you Adam West Batman skin to tie you over for the next 6 months.
Yeah,
so
and
you can
and
play
it's
a
like,
20-minute Mr. Freeze run through or something.
Yeah,
hey, by the way,
it's,
just to ask you guys, I'm playing the Division right now. Do I still have to? Or are we going to do that?
You can.
Can I do something
I'm
else?
Still waiting for mine to update, so that might be something we have to do later. When you can definitely switch that off and play something else. I'm sorry.
Right, I'm
yeah,
gonna go
I
back
only got
on
like another,
I feel like an
two,
asshole that you've been playing that this whole time.
Yeah,
I'm going
and
back
I got
to
like
Sonic
another
the
like
Hedgehog
15, too. 20 minutes anyway. But yeah, it's like you said, it's missing. It had a good idea. The idea of it was cool. and it was fun for that first 30 levels, and, you know, like you're saying, and I think that was another thing that bothered me is the whole, remember I've been talking about the whole XP thing? I hated that it stopped at 30, and I hated even more that you ran into enemies that were level 34, but you can't get to level 34, and that drove me insane. I'm like, well, you can get this, the better armor so you can hang with them, but it's like, but they're still
then just put a fucking
level
door there.
34.
Just put a 34 there. Don't change anything. Just let me feel better.
Here's the thing with the game. To me, I always look at this the same way I look at Call of Duty, Titanfall, every game where there's a leveling sort of system. And I really think that they need to raise the cap on everything. Because if you want me to play this game that long, yeah, I want, like, Grand Theft Auto, they get it right. There's a guy in Grand Theft Auto that's a level 398. And you go, wow, he's been playing the fuck out of this game. But I like that. I like that the level represents his kind of dedication to the grind, you know what I mean? Making it awesome. I think that's how the division should be. You should just, by level 30, just keep fucking going. And then when you do run by somebody,
I mean, fuck, even Call of Duty is doing
200.
That. Like, the new Call of Duty, after you prestige 10, you just keep leveling up after that until you get to 1,000.
Yo,
and
that, see,
that's awesome.
I play Madden Mobile. It's a phone game. It's a little card collecting, you know, football video game on the phone. I've been playing it for almost 2 years, every day. I actually play that game. Probably, I do. I play it more than I play anything else. And you can pay money. You can pay real money. And I never did up until about 6 months ago, where I'll drop $5 here, $5 there. But at that point, I felt like I've gotten my money's worth with it. But even a cell phone game, the initial level cap for the season was level 30, right? I hit level 30 pretty quick. Then they raised it to level 40. Then they raised it to level 50. Then they added in prestige levels on top of that, which earned you new logos, which earned you coins, which are even a mobile game from EA, nonetheless. You know what I mean? Can't spell steal without EA. But even a fucking EA mobile game has had better support, and they've actually thought things through on a larger scale. And the thing is, I've put money into this game. On August 18th, I think, the game resets. So my team, as is, will not exist anymore outside of being a legacy team that I get to use a couple times a week. And I still feel comfortable putting money into this game. Whereas a multi-million dollar game like Division can't hold my attention. I don't feel like it earned my money, my business. And there's no replayability. There's no reason for me to go back. I was just playing the game 5 minutes ago because I thought that's what we were supposed to be doing. And I had to ask you guys to stop. I'm a grown man. I shouldn't have to ask anybody anything. But I'm like, yo, can I please just do something else? And that's pretty hard to swallow. It really is. I mean, when you think about it, that's pretty bad, man. So.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it's just. Yeah, I just really hope that doesn't become the trend because you know what, like you said.
Does anybody else look at like the DLC for the Division and just instantly know that at some point or another it's going the zombie direction? Or is that just me?
Well, yeah, what was it? They dropped that trailer at E3, which nobody knew it was like the Division. It was a terrible trailer. The guy, he's going through the supermarket and it's all snowed in and it's dark and then you hear people like chasing him and he's looking around for something, and that's what I thought. I was like, what the fuck was this, like a zombie game? And it turned out it was Division, and it was the next thing, a DLC called Survival.
And like, I just feel like the last DLC in the Division is going to be the virus is mutated, everybody's a zombie, keep your distance. You're fucked.
I'm completely out of it. I'm completely gone then. Because you know what? I was telling Jeff that the one thing I liked about the Division is there was no monsters for me. I like that, hey, this town's fucked up, there's crazy people out there, you're just killing people. I've done the zombie. When is. I feel like, isn't the cycle supposed to change? Doesn't it go like zombies, ninja, pirates, robots? Like,
and aliens.
We, like,
with aliens.
We're done with zombies and aliens.
I think we're
so.
Due for vampires again sometime soon. It's been a while.
I don't think we're going to be done with the zombie shit until The Walking Dead is gone. I think it is.
It's just, we've done it. Like, you know what I mean?
We have.
I hope they don't do it. It's like, zombies and Call of Duty is more than enough. That's all I need anymore. That's fun enough, you know?
I would rather never play a zombies mode in Call of Duty ever again. I think it is stupid. I think it's bad.
You know what I wish they would bring back was fucking... You know what was really awesome and they never brought it back was Spec Ops mode. I really like that. Where you and one of your friends went through, they had these little small little missions and that you did little shit, little ops, and you earned shit and everything and leveled up and customized crap, and it was fun. And then they're like, nah, we're not gonna. You guys want zombies?
The only like side game mode I've liked in a Call of Duty in forever is in one of the worst games, Ghost, and I liked the aliens mode. I thought that was fun.
Oh, but one more thing I wanted to say is like,
I played the shit out of Ghost. Like, I would go back and play Ghost again if it meant that I could wipe the memory of Advanced Warfare from my mind.
Yeah, that game was horrible. But yeah,
that is by far one of the worst games I've ever played in my entire life. And I played some shit games.
What you said, Jesse, is back to what you said before about your Madden cell phone game that I was thinking about. Is you know how you said, well, as of late, I started dropping $5, $10.
Yeah.
Maybe, like, what you're saying, because you felt like, you played this game long enough, you got your money's worth. Maybe that is what Destiny should have done, and that's what the Division should have done. That would have, you know, if they took that risk, like, that it would have paid off. Because, now, I'll ask you guys this. How would you feel about the Division if you played it and it was free? And when you wanted to upgrade and get the shit, you gave the money. Or it's only $20.
That'd be better.
Or Destiny.
But there are certain
games
that even do that wrong. Like, fucking DC Universe Online is on Xbox One now. And if you play it on the free version, you have to wait an hour just to play the game. Like, the
I totally don't agree with that either. To say, faster, you have to pay.
It's essentially saying if you want to play the game when you want to play the game, you have to pay. Like, I get it, and it's fine that I should have to buy different power sets or costumes or whatever would have you.
Absolutely,
but for me to be able to start the game within a reasonable amount of time, like, I was really excited when I saw that it was coming to Xbox One, because I remember playing it over at you guys' house on the PS4 and being like, oh man, this is cool, I like this, it's fun, you know, it's not like the best game I've ever played, but it's a cool little thing to throw in. And so when I saw it was coming to fucking Xbox One, I was like, oh, dope. And then I was thrown into my very first login queue, and I had no idea that fucking existed. I was like, what? I have to wait an hour to play the game? I'm number 10,500,000 fucking, that's stupid.
Well, the reason I think that the pay-to-play thing works in my Madden game, and the thing is that it's extremely difficult. I played a full season last year, and I played a full season this year. My overall at the end of the year last year was 100. And right now, I still have like a month or two to go, and my overall is 102. And that's kind of a significant difference. Like, once you get to that level, like, trying to go up overall 1 point, it's difficult to do. And if you spend money on packs, you can either spend money on packs, or you can spend money on stamina. Once you're prestiged and maxed out, stamina is not too much of an issue. But the fact of the matter is, if you spend money, it's still kind of a gamble, because you're buying packs, you're not buying players. So you don't know what you're going to get. You could spend $20 and get garbage. You know what I mean? But it has an auction house where you can, if you know how to work the system, you can actually be a benefactor of the system without spending any real money. But they also will let you buy things like packs and bundles with in-game points. So really what I'm saying is that if you're going to do something where you put in microtransactions or things like that, you can't guarantee somebody success, because then it comes back to the whole thing like John was saying with the gun in Call of Duty, where, you know, some kid can spend $5 and get the same thing I worked my ass off for. You know what I mean? And it's going to give them an advantage. It's not necessarily the case, because you don't know what you're getting. You're just getting yourself the opportunity to become better. So if you like the game enough, you'll take that risk. It's a risk-reward thing. But if you don't, then you won't spend the money.
Because, you know what? It's because it's something. It's like Destiny and whatever, the Division, are missing that, like, that secret sauce. Like, because secret sauce that, like, you know, that, like, Final Fantasy VII had, or 9, or any of the Final Fantasies, or RPGs, or remember, like, the grind.
I've got
remember
nothing good to say about Final
the grind. Remember playing, like, the old school Final Fantasies, and you'd go, all right, this is the area where I need to go, because I can kill this enemy, he drops good, whatever, good XP, I can level up here. I don't mind doing that. Like, I don't mind doing that, but the game rewarded you with that, where, like, now you're a beast. You know what I mean? Like, now, because I do that. I like that with games where I, like, you know what? You can grind, or you can keep following the story. It's going to be a lot harder. You know what I mean? Or, hey, practice. You know what I mean? That's what it feels like. Practice.
Yeah.
And that's what the Division is missing. I wanted the Division to be like, hey, yo, let's go back to the project housing, clear out these motherfuckers for a while, so then when we go, you know what I mean, hey, we're fucking ready to go. And all it was like, hey, let me go clear this out, and I get this one thing that, you know, maybe
the game's always one step ahead, so it doesn't matter what gun you really have. They're just gonna make it as challenging as it was gonna be regardless. If you had a shit
remember,
gun
like I
and
said,
you're
it,
level
it's,
24
it's a,
then, you know, yeah, you're having the same struggles at the next level and the next level and the next level. And since they cap you out, you're never going to get rid of that struggle. And I know exactly what you're thinking of, John. You're thinking of dodging 100 lightning bolts and getting an ultimate weapon in Final Fantasy X that made the rest of the game that much easier. And I remember that. And you know what? But the fact is that when you went to go fight the crazy boss, I think it was like Ultima Weapon or something like that. Yeah, you killed him in 2 hits, but you put your fucking work in trying to prepare yourself for it. You know what I mean? You didn't just show
and
up.
That's,
and
because remember, because Josh, you were there. Remember that?
I was there when you beat him.
Like, wow, that was so anticlimactic. Like it's over. Like it was a Tyson fight, and it's like. Yeah,
but it gives you a sense of control that you actually had something to do with your own success. It's not
exactly.
Just
and
binary
code dictating
Destiny, what's going
that's
on.
That's what they're missing is like that, like, hey, I'm rewarding you for your grind. You know what I mean? Like, instead of like, no, he's still tough. You still got it. And it's like, no, well, I've been working out. I should be tougher than you. You know what I mean? Like, and that's what I feel like that's what was missing, because I'm like, I've been doing the hit list or whatever that they got now in the Division, where you get collect intel, doing these little clear out the areas, little missions, then you can go trade the intel in, get information on a named guy that's somewhere, and you have to go take him out. And he always has a chance, a really good chance of dropping green shit, the lime green shit, whatever, the elite shit. And you know, you keep doing it, and actually they started, it kind of started working, because I was like, okay, I'm getting green shit. I was like, I fucking have leveled up. I've done, you know, what I need to do. And then I go in there. I should be able to take him out. And then it's like, they show a harder version of that. And, you know, the guys are, I should be able to kill him, right? Like, I've maxed my guy out, so I should be able to do it. And I'll go in the fight, and then they'll mop the floor with me. You know what I mean? And I just, like you said, I feel like I'm on a leash. Like, hey, you can grind and level up till
John,
here. But these guys are still gonna be here.
You did include your audio, right?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Okay. Because I remember Jesse saying that he included his, and then I was like, oh shit.
Yeah, no, I included mine. Okay. But
So I'm playing the crew right now, John, and because it was free. And I just found that, like, life-size Hot Wheels track.
Up on
have
the
you
ledge.
Seen this?
This has to be it.
Yeah, because you can get a monster truck. You can turn your car into a fucking, you can add a monster truck kit to like any car you have.
That's
and then go, you can like go
cool.
race the track.
That's kind of cool.
Yeah,
like, I'm doing it my little
bike
right
did.
Now. See, another part about it. That's another part about games, and I can relate this back to the Division because I know that's what we're supposed to be talking about. But I'm just screwing around, and I found something interesting. You know what I mean? Like, that sense of discovery is why we play games. If you know, people watch movies and read books or whatever, and they're still media. They're still entertainment media. But at the same time, they're not interactive entertainment media. The movie is presented to you. The book is written. The game puts you in the driver's seat, in the fucking line of fire, in whatever it is you want to say. You know, whatever kind of a game you're playing. And this actually is something like, all right, I just stumbled across something interesting. Can I really do anything here? I don't know. I'm probably just going to crash a bunch. But the fact of the matter is that I'm here. It's something. I didn't expect it, and there it is. And in the division, I basically just... there was maybe one or two things I ran into that I didn't anticipate, but they were all in the first couple of days. And I felt like with games like Borderlands existing, that you should have known better, because they were so successful. They did so well, making you stay interested, whether it was with loot hunts where you knew if you wanted a sniper rifle, you knew you had to kill this guy. If you wanted a crazy shotgun, you knew you had to farm this guy. So at least you had some sort of a direction, you know? But they had humor, they had characters, they had interesting colors, for crying out loud. There was other shit going on, and it just never materialized for me personally.
And I think what hurt both games is there's actually a video on YouTube that compares the E3 version of The Division to the game that came out. And the whole thing was, did you know the E3 version? The entire area was potentially the Dark Zone. Like, there were
really?
Other players everywhere in the city. Yeah, I watched the E3 thing. They get into a firefight with other players just in the city. And the whole city was just, was a big, everyone's everywhere. It's fucking the Wild West kind of deal.
That
like,
would have made more sense in a way. I mean, because then at least there would have been more places for people to go, so you wouldn't feel quite as,
claustrophobic.
You know,
yeah, so they, they showed that stuff like how it could be, and I think that both games kind of suffered from their own hype. Like, there's a video for Destiny, which is hilarious, it gets posted, and it's the developer talking, you know, those dev diaries bullshit, and he's like, yeah, in Destiny, wherever you look, you can go there. You guys are going to be traveling the planets and exploring the planets with your friends, and random events will happen and this and that. And then it cuts to the kid playing Destiny, and it's the early part of the game, and there's this little, like, 5-foot cliff and, like, some ruined cars, and he goes to jump at it, and it says he's out of bounds and dies.
Yeah.
and it's like that.
But
shit,
see, that's what I meant with like Destiny. When they first mentioned it, the game that they had planned is not.
I was thinking No Man's
game.
Sky with Halo.
Yeah.
Like Halo meets No Man's Sky, where you get on your speeder bike from the or your jet plane, your spaceship from the tower, fly yourself down to fucking Earth, get out of it, meet up with I can meet up with Josh, and then we start going. Like, that's what I thought it was going to be. Instead, everything was broken up into zones. Like, the worst thing I hated about Destiny that I liked The Division way more for is I hated that it had that Capcom thing where after we did a strike, a fucking timer comes up, it does a countdown, and then sends everybody back up into orbit. You know what I mean? Like, at the main menu kind of deal. And it's like, why can we do that strike and then me and you hop on the speeder bike and go and do a raid? You know what I mean? Do something else on the planet, you know, and that, but so now it's like, so this game is leveled. There are no planets, you're not exploring, you're going to level one, and there's level two over there, you know what I mean? And that, I hate that shit, because I was totally thinking of, you know, I want that fucking, you know, open world, I want Fallout, you know, I want us to, hey, here's a giant world, take your buddies, you know, go out there, you know, that's what I thought it was going to be, but instead it was, hey, take your buddies in the lobby, to the menu,
go fuck them.
To the zone, do the mission, and then come back. You know, like insert quarter. That's what I was looking for.
The game we got with Destiny is not the game that we were promised with it, and that's why like one of the main developers left. Like he was really upset with the direction the game was going, I think he went on Twitter or something, kind of bashing the game about how it came out and everything. But I think. That's what just kind of happens with a lot of games. Like, I don't think that's the case with The Division. I think they just, you know, I think they just shoved it out too far. And they were just like, yeah, here it is.
Mm-hmm.
Come on. Be excited.
Yeah. But it, like us in high school
doing projects the night before.
Oh, yeah, no. Exactly. Yeah. It just, that, and that's what it just, it did. It just kind of, It missed that mark, man, where it could have been something that, and it leaves you, and then, and now, and like you said, it leaves everyone, it leaves us now, look at us, look how wary, like, we're talking, like, of other games, like, I don't know, like, fuck you, Eddie Murphy, you know what I mean, like, you know, like, you're not getting me again, yeah, don't say it's something that it isn't, you know, like, cause at least, like, cause it, really, if you think about Destiny, kind of had the same setup as Borderlands.
You remember when Fable was coming out?
You could leave Sanctuary, me and Jesse could leave together, and yeah, their Borderlands broken in, up into zones, I guess, but it was continuous, like, me and Jesse, we didn't have to leave and go to a menu to go to the next zone. It was, hey, you're on the back of my vehicle I'm driving. Here's a loading screen. We're both going through the loading screen. All right, we're in the next zone. Like, it was still a little bit more.
It was more seamless than Destiny. Like,
yeah, absolutely.
And, but do you remember talking on the subject of like what was promised and what was given? You remember when Fable was announced and the guy's like, "You'll be able to plant a tree."
Oh my God, he's Peter Molyneux, the biggest douchebag and fucking biggest liar, and fucking in the history of video games. Yeah, what did they say in the beginning of the game? You could plant a seed, and then over time, it would grow into a fucking tree. And you could, like, chop it down or some shit like that, and the world would always be changing, and it was supposed to be, like, real life.
Do you think that when he's saying all these things, there's some guy in the back going, like wait, trying to wave him down, like, no, don't say that.
No. Oh, yeah,
I'm
yeah,
sure
we,
there
we,
was.
We don't
Unfortunately,
that
guy wasn't loud enough.
Yeah, like, he's sitting
Peter,
there. That is the complete
Peter,
opposite of what we told you this game would do. Like, that is
Peter,
not
that,
that none of that
technology doesn't. He's like, Peter, that technology doesn't exist yet. We can't do that.
We are not
he's like
there.
The professor.
I took.
He's like the professor of Futurama. He's like, I'm going to build a giant monster with robot crazy freeway ramps for arms. It's just like, slow it down, man. Like, you're not gonna do all that. You're just not, you know? Come on. Didn't they end up canceling, like, everything else that he had his name on?
The Lionhead Studios shut down, yeah.
Yeah, shut down, yeah, that's what I thought.
And that whole Fable Legends that they were supposed to, Microsoft was wearing. Yeah, this is gonna tank.
Yep. Actually, I think it went to Kickstarter.
Oh my god. No, a card game. Our card game version of it.
Oh, speaking of card games, that might have been the thing that I'm most excited about from E3 is fucking the new version of Gwent from The Witcher.
Yeah. Fuck Gwent. I hate Gwent.
You're out of your mind.
I hate Pulse Generator.
Gwent
is
the best part of that game.
All right,
that
game is fantastic. I go to the notice board in The Witcher, and it's like this. All right. There's a giant fire-breathing griffin in the woods that needs to be tracked down and killed, or this guy at the bar over here wants to play a card game. And I'm like, well, I'm not doing that. Like, I'm gonna go track down the fucking griffin. Maybe the rest of the game.
I'm sorry.
Dumb,
like,
I would go play cards.
Like, I never go for the card games in like when Final Fantasy VIII came out. I didn't care. I didn't care about that card game. Fucking.
You didn't
like,
care about Triple Triad?
No, I didn't.
Like,
I did not like Triple Triad. And they, like, every time one of those things comes out, I always think it's going to be the part of the game that I'm going to hate the most. And
did you know how to play it?
Yeah, I was good at it. But it's just not, like,
did you want to start a game using your rules and ours? that was the thing that drove me crazy with that fucking game, is I loved it until I went to, like, fucking wherever that city was, and they're like, yeah, you want to play a game using your rules and ours? And then I lost, and they took like all my fucking cards. I was like, what are you doing? Well, that's how we play. I didn't realize at that point that you had to like say no like 6 times, and then they just give up. So, sorry, memory road.
Yeah, no, Gwent was my least favorite thing about The Witcher.
I played it.
There's one mission where you have to play. There's one mission you had to play a guy for information, and I kept losing, and I'm like, this is stupid, and I went back, restarted the mission, and threatened him. I was like, I'm gonna fucking kill you if you don't tell me. The guy's like, whoa, man, like, hey, we don't have to, and then I killed
hey,
him, and
just
I took
cards.
What was on. I killed the whole bar. Yeah, the town didn't like me, but I got the fucking information, and I'm playing Old Maid with this douchebag, and the fucking back to the bar. I'm trying.
Crazy. Gwent is so much fun.
Fuck Gwent. I hated Gwent. Like I said.
Fuck.
How boring are you? It's like, hey, we can go slay a dragon, or we can go play fucking Uno. What do you want to do? It's like, glad I bought this game to play a card game.
What would you think of a multiplayer?
I bought my cell phone so I can play solitaire on it.
What would you think of a multiplayer Witcher? Like an open world multiplayer Witcher.
It would ruin it. It would ruin it because the Witcher, what made the Witcher awesome is it had that same feeling as Skyrim where I'm in it, I'm involved, I'm invested in the world, and everything was written so well that you get to explore that seeing some douchebag doing jumping jacks or running circles around me when I go into town would totally break me out of the immersion of the game, you know what I mean? Like,
see,
that game
I disagree.
Had
I disagree.
I hate that. That was
I don't know how you could
games.
Do
like,
it. Like,
I
know you could do it with just like you could set it back in time a little bit to where all the Witcher schools were still around, and that explains
like
the multiple Witchers. But
certain games, I do feel
I agree with John in the sense that I want to keep a certain level of immersion in the game, and yeah, like if you're just playing, like if you were playing with friends, then you can do that. Like, but if there's just like everybody running around, then it's gonna get ruined because you're just gonna have assholes. I mean, I'm an asshole.
Yeah.
I'm not an asshole in a video game. Like,
yeah, and
well,
that's
I mean,
like
I just see
games,
it as
certain games do warrant it, like Skyrim. And you know what? Not even a lot of people make Skyrim like at the most 4-player co-op.
Not even.
The most,
I would say
I can't
too.
Tell you. I can't tell you. I can't tell you how many times in Skyrim I found an awesome weapon. I was like, man, Jesse uses axes all the time. I wish I could give it to him. Because I don't use it, you know what I mean? And I found this amazing, you know, axe.
I think
a
two-player, I think two-player for something like that would make the most sense.
Yeah,
because for the soul, well, think about it. I mean, Fallout and Skyrim, obviously both Bethesda, but they're built around the fact that, I mean, what's such a huge part of that game is having companions.
Yep.
I mean, what better companion than having somebody you already know who plays it as much as you, like my wife and I, put together. Yeah, that's weird, right? I put in like fucking 400 hours in Skyrim. My wife put in like 500 hours in Skyrim. John's girl did the same thing. Yeah, my wife, right?
Yeah,
but,
yeah.
I mean,
Stacy got every fucking achievement in Skyrim.
Yeah, and she's like
one.
The only person I know that's been able to do that. But the point I'm saying is that if you and your friends have that much of a game in common, you know what I mean? And you're talking about it and you watch each other play it. How dope would it be able to take control of one of the companions? You know what I mean? Not even make it a split screen thing. Make it a like a Diablo style thing where it's still that one screen and you kind of have, you know, you can only go so far away from each other or something like that. But I think that it wouldn't take away from the immersion. I think it would make you feel like you had something else going on. It would make the experience different, but deeper in a way. You know what I mean?
I think that no matter what, anytime you're playing with other people, it's going to take you out of the immersion of the game, unless you guys are just complete nerds and you're like role-playing the fucking game.
Yeah.
Like,
well, I mean, think about
I
like World of Warcraft and all those
like,
other games,
you know?
That are like
I'd
supposed
like
to be
someone,
huge
I,
immersion,
I,
but
I
they're MMOs.
Of
you know what I mean? People
like
go so crazy over
like,
games like that, but they're playing it with a million other people.
Not,
they have that sense of
loser,
immersion.
Like,
you know what I mean?
Hey, man, let's go up here and do that. Nah, leave them alone.
I don't know. I think it could be done, but I think it would have to be in the developer's mind to be.
I'm getting high right now. I don't know, that's what I think about that.
Instructor,
ready for extraction. Now you're gonna stop talking, John? He talked through Jesse's whole thing.
You know what I mean? That would make it awesome, you know what I mean?
You're a dick.
Why am I a dick?
No, I was talking about John.
Why?
Because Jesse was saying something and you literally talked over him for 2 minutes straight. Like, I had both of you talking the entire time.
Oh, I didn't hear John at all.
You didn't hear him at all?
Nah.
Fucking, you were both.
Huh,
I don't even
just
what
a second
now.
Ago?
Like, I was waiting. I was waiting for, like, one of you to let the other one go the whole time. It's just both of you talking over each other.
Hey, that's the history of our relationship. That's
and it really
brother.
Is.
I'm not going to give in, and neither is he.
But no, I get.
I'm not afraid of black guys.
Like what John was saying was that like that's one of the things that he worries about the most in a game is like I don't want to like be playing a game somebody jump in and then me be wondering is he taking it as seriously as I am because I don't want to look like a fucking nerd.
Yeah, this is coming from the guy who routinely falls asleep with a controller in his hands. I need to make sure that you're on board here. Yeah,
you need to be as tired as I am.
Yeah,
well, that's see, it, that's another litmus test of how good a game is. Hey, if it can keep John awake, this has got to be good.
Yeah, so Batman Rise of Sinzu is not at the top of the list.
It's not a good one. It wasn't good at all. It was too much. It looked too much like the animated series, and I love taking naps watching that show. It was too close to it.
I think if you were gonna do it, like the only way to really do it would be four players at the most, and that's it. Like, and even that to it, like look at the way they did Elder Scrolls Online. It seemed like it'd be fun, it'd be a good concept,
terrible.
But it's nothing like actual Elder Scrolls. Like it's
it was
terrible.
So boring. It was so fucking boring.
I was horribly disappointed with that.
You know, we bought it. Amanda played it. I never even made a character, I don't think. I think I made it halfway through the character create, and she's like, you want to watch TV? And I was like, yeah. Amanda, I think that was the last of it, so.
I rented it from Redbox. It took like a full day for it to finish installing because of all the bullshit. And then I played it, and I was
like, you have that it takes a whole day to install a game?
No, that was off of the disc. Like, I rented it from Redbox. Like, it just, I don't know. It just, that game was either huge or it had a whole bunch of updates. I don't know. But it took forever. It took, like, it didn't take a whole day. It took, like, an hour and a half. And, like, I'm just like, what? And I fucking started playing it. I was like, this would be bad if it was just another named, like, MMO.
Yeah.
Like this is just
bad. If they didn't have the credibility of Elder Scrolls to run off.
It's like, you made it worse by putting the Elder Scrolls name on it, because I had a certain level of expectation with it. Like, you made it worse. And then, like, the whole you can't play with your friends unless you're, like, in the same faction or, like, that was weird.
Yeah, that was weird. I do remember hearing about that. Like, if you were a Khajiit and your friend was, like, an Argonian, you couldn't do anything about it.
Yeah, like, it's like, what?
That's promoting racism. That's, like, absolutely promoting racism.
We don't hang out.
Is John talking? Because I can't hear him again.
Nah, he's I think he went to go take a poop.
Oh, okay.
No, no.
Not pooping. He's not pooping.
I'm sorry, I made a hot roast, and I'm making pulled pork sandwiches today, and I was trying to keep them in the slow cooker for like 12 hours.
You fatty. Well, on that note, I'm gonna go because I'm tired of talking to you guys.
Not bad for the
this
bed,
is Jesse,
for the first stream.
Up and out.
I'll send y'all a link to it. And
yeah, it was good. It was good. You know what? I think once we if we're really gonna kind of do this for a side little hobby, we just gotta. Yeah, think of like little, like do it how the other people, just little segments, like, hey, this is the new shit, what do you think about this?
The next time I'll have like a little, kind of like a schedule of what we're supposed to talk about when, and we'll go from there.
Yeah, it's fun. Yeah. You know, it's just good.
Maybe what we can talk about is what we're going to try to plan together, you know, while people are still listening for fucking next time. So that's what they want to hear, is us fucking talking about how we don't know what we're doing. Everybody. Good call, guys.
Hey, it's free. It's free right now.
Yeah, there you go. Shut up.
They want
it. It might cost something down the road.
Hey, if they want the exclusive behind the scenes, well, they're just gonna have to. Have to pay 99 cents on the iTunes.
Xbox, not the Twitch. Like
we mean to. We figure out how to do that.
Figure out how to charge you. It's over.
We'll give you $10 for the other $20.